Good afternoon, my friends. Brian with VetteSource here, checking in today, where we are going to go ahead and follow up on the short video I had out a few days ago, talk about this very large engine here that I kind of teased about what it was. So we're going to talk a little bit more about this. Now, if you've watched me for a while, I've been around for a while, you've noticed I do tend to like big block Chevys. In fact, there's a couple of them sitting right here that I've detailed. In fact, I did a detailed video on this big block Chevy probably a year and a half ago. Of course, we've got our 427 Thor, the 427 Corvette here, and other big blocks that I like. This motor here, this particular engine I'm going to detail for you today, is actually kind of an odd animal. Now, it is a big block Chevy, but it's not a big block Chevy. So the big block Chevy is an interesting motor in that it went through many variations. In fact, seven generations or marks, as they're called, Mark 1s through Mark 7s, if you count the W head motors from 1958, and were really produced for 50 years, counting again that first W head motor. If you count just a traditional style like this looks motor, the Mark 4, 5, 6, and 7s, Gen 4 through 7s, other words, these were produced for well over 40 years, from 65 to 2009. And in fact, this engine and one other engine serve have the notable distinction of that they had a longer production run of any other manufacturer in existence. In fact, the number one spot is only taken by the small block Chevy. And then, of course, the big block Chevy, which was designed and created for the need to have bigger motors in their trucks and other cars to handle this more power they needed output. So what this motor is the seventh generation of the Mark 7 engine of the big block Chevy series, okay? This is a Chevrolet engine, and any guy that knows big blocks will recognize it, but it is a very odd animal because nothing on this motor basically interchanges with the early generations, okay? So this engine is actually called, RPO code is the L18. It's a Gen 7 8.1 liter, 496 cubic inches. And it was the last big block made. They made this up until December, I think it was December 12th of 2009, and that was when big block engine production shut down at Tonawanda. I've heard, I may be wrong, they still are making this engine in an industrial capacity for Pennstar, maybe Navistar. I don't remember exactly, but I know the marine versions may still be out there. This is actually a marine version engine. That's why it's painted black versus a traditional cast aluminum intake manifold, simply because it's done for corrosive inhibitors to make it more amenable to saltwater type boats. But anyway, this engine alone here had so many upgrades, and there's so much information on this motor, so much different than a previous generation big block. I actually had to do a lot more that I can talk about in this video that was done to this motor. GM actually went all out on this and really designed a really good motor. So let's talk about this just a little bit. So this essentially became an option in 2001, what they called the heavy duty trucks, the GMT 800s, right? It was the 3/4 tons and the 1-ton chassis. And you could get this. Now, if it was in the trucks, you had to get this with an Allison transmission. If it was in the Suburban 3/4 tons, you'd get this with a 480 behind it. And of course, a 14-bolt rear end in a Suburban or Yukon. And if you'll remember, part of the reason I ended up with this motor and the others was back in February, my older son made a joke that I've used my GMT 400 big block truck for so many years, it deserved to be semi-retired. So I went looking around and found the 02 3500 crew cab with the 8.1. And then found, which was all torn apart into pieces. And then I found the 04 Yukon XL, which had dropped the number one rod from oil starvation, with the 8.1. So I ended up grabbing both of those. And then after I found them, I also found this crate engine, which I detailed in a video too, kind of running back through hill country with these two 8.1 engines in the back of my truck. So anyway, this was offered starting in 2001. As basically GM outlined this as a diesel alternative for everybody, right? If you did not want the expense, the $5,000 Duramax, this engine was available in the trucks for $850, I believe, right? Now, the only thing about it was, if you got this engine in the trucks, it required the $2,295 Allison transmission option, the 1000, which then bumped it to a little over $3,000, but still a very good value for what you were getting out of this, right? Now, like I said before, these parts don't interchange on this motor. Actually, over 80% of the parts were changed in this engine versus the other big block Chevy. So that's why it confuses people when they look at it. It's just such an odd animal between the two motors. So this was the same kind of thing as the 744, or listen to me, 454. It had a 4.25 inch stroke, but what they did is bore, but they did the stroke 4.37 to get that 496 cubic inches out of it. This also gave them the ability, they've got, of course, the 4-bolt main block, the internally balanced crank like you'd have on a 427, and it's also got the hydraulic roller set up in it. So it's pretty well advanced for what it actually is. The final numbers on these range from about 340 horsepower at 4,200 RPM, all the way up to, and then 450 foot-pounds of torque at 3,200 RPM. So these were very low-end grunt motors, but you can actually get a lot of horsepower out of them, just like with a lot of the big block stuff. And the thing that was good about it is 90% of the rear or peak torque on this motor was from 17 to 4,300. So they made a lot of interesting, not claims, if you will, but comparisons against the Ford and Dodge, the V10s of the era. And the Dodge and V10 and Ford V10s didn't even come close to this. Their horsepower numbers were off. The torque numbers were off. This was really a stump puller in comparison. I think they even did a comparison test with them loaded with like 12,000 pounds behind them in 0-60 quarter mile times and everything. And the Chevy, this motor outdid them all. In fact, what's interesting now, Ford has reintroduced their 7.3 gas engine with no, no direct injection, none of the fancy stuff, just a plain old overhead valve, acting like they've reinvented the wheel. And I get why they're talking that, because this has been 20 years since this came out. But this has always been one of the superior motors. And you'll get a lot of guys, I don't argue about it, because I know guys like diesels for their reasons and they're good motors. But you'll get a lot of guys that get really territorial over which motor is better. And I'll tell you the truth, the diesel, the early Duramaxes are quite powerful, but these 8.1s are nothing to shake a stick at. They will pull houses off foundations if you really want them to do it. Now, the other unique thing about this when they redesigned it is that the block and everything else has enough different parts that you're going to get confused. So kind of starting at the top here, obviously, you can see this intake manifold's different, right? This is a totally raised runner, aluminum, sand cast. Actually, I think it was styrofoam in sand. It's a special casting method they did for this. The heads, obviously, are 18-bolt heads versus, I think, the regular Mark IVs are 15 bolts. And you can see here these water passages where the water outlets, they revise the cooling system on these motors. These are cathedral port heads, just like the LS motors get. And also the engine itself has all metric fasteners. The oil pan rails are redesigned. And then, of course, I was talking about the engine bearings are a different alloy material that would allow them to last longer. Okay, so very interesting thing. The one of the more interesting odd things about this, of course, too, is that they revised the firing order on this motor. So if you're a Chevy guy, you know that 1-8-4-3-6-5-7-2 is the standard that every guy gearhead knows about. This engine actually is 1-8-7-2-6-5-4-3, which reduced wear on the main bearing and allowed it to survive longer than it normally would, which was kind of interesting because when you look at the motor and you really look closely, if you didn't know what you're looking at, you'd say this is an LS engine. That's the other thing they did, is they adopted all the LS architecture to this engine. So not only do you have the coil packs like an LS motor, right? You've also got the cam and the crank sensors in the motor right back here. You've also got a drive-by-wire throttle system, right? And you've also got the entire engine management system, the PCM and everything, and the CAN bus system, right? from the LS Motors is on this. So essentially what they did is they adopted the entire LS architecture to the motor that had been around since 1965 in this version, right? So it was quite interesting, and that's what I think flummoxed a lot of people at first, because they weren't able to modify this like they thought they were going to, because none of this stuff interchanges. You can't put those heads on an older Mark 4, Mark 5, Mark 6 big block. Can't use the intake. The pistons are actually shorter in this motor. I think the crank will interchange, I think, and maybe a couple other pieces, but the timing chain cover doesn't interchange. The oil pan, you can see, is aluminum. I actually had to take the marine version off of this while I put it in the truck. But you can see that's the truck version of the oil pan. So a lot of differences in these that guys will go out and buy it because it's a big cubic inch motor, and then they realize, oh crap, I can't use anything from this motor at all. Now, when it came out, this had a service life of 200,000 miles is what they called it. Now, I can tell you that's really a conservative number. My 7400 in my black truck has 240,000 miles. And I think finally, I'm starting to get an exhaust leak at the between the head and the exhaust manifold, but that's the first thing I've really had to do. I haven't even cracked the valve covers off that motor. And I have not been gentle with that truck whatsoever. The interesting thing about it too is that we've got, in part of the design process, you'll notice there's no Pcv system on this motor anywhere. It's all internal like it is on the LS motors as well. And then it, the stainless steel exhaust manifolds, this one did not come with it because it was a crate motor. And then one of the coolest thing I thought about it was you've got the catastrophe, in the event of a catastrophic failure of the coolant system, it can actually tell and it will shut down four of the cylinders so you don't destroy the motor before taking it, if we're getting into the shop. So it's just a lot of cool stuff they did. Now, these get a little bit more difficult. I'm still diagnosing an electrical issue on the green crew cab truck. It's one small wire that's giving me a check engine light. Runs like a champ, but I still can't get it inspected because I've got the check engine light on still for a torque management code, is what's really weird. So, but anyway, when you got the architecture with the LS motors, you also got the difficulty with that electrical system as it is, which is, to me, the one thing that detracts. The other thing I thought was really cool is that when they designed these engines, part of their durability testing was they took this thing out and they ran it for 300 hours or basically 12 days straight at wide open throttle and it didn't blow up. Now, I like those kind of numbers. In fact, even the ZR1 had similar type things they did. They ran that at wide open throttle, I think, for 24 hours, and that was one of their big selling points on the ZR1 motor. But to run that big block Chevy for 12 days, right, with a wide open throttle is very impressive. So I'm not advocating, you know, for one over the other, but I will tell you that in my history with big blocks, and I've been driving my black truck for almost 20 years as a daily driver and just in my business and what I do, punishing it quite relentlessly, this is a motor that will hold up for ages. Now, I am gonna preface, also add to that though, this motor, these trucks equipped with this motor are not that easy to find anymore. And when you do find them, you're going to pay for them. Like I said, they have the simplicity of not being a diesel engine, right? There's not the complexity of it. And it is still the basic architecture of a big block Chevy. And it's just as powerful. The gas mileage is gonna suffer straight up. I mean, it's gonna get 10 miles to the gallon. I've seen guys do 6-8 miles to the gallon based on the way they're driving. But I'm gonna be curious to see, once we stick this in the Yukon, we'll see what kind of gas mileage it gets. And I'm curious to see what kind of gas mileage the Jolly Green Giant, as I affectionately recall it, the crew cab dually gets with this 8.1 in it. So basically just an overview, like I said. Very cool engine, unique, right? Vortec 8100 that not a lot of people have seen or even heard about. And if you've ever had an interest in these, definitely one of those motors to talk about. So if you got anything to add to the discussion, if you got personal experience with these, as far as some of the oil consumption issues these do have, they're known to burn a little bit excess oil more than normal. or your experience on the road or towing with them, make sure drop a comment down below. Let me know what you think of it, and we'll go from there. And if you guys are interested in seeing me the process, I'm going to be dropping this into the Yukon here in the next few weeks. If you'd be interested in seeing some of what I do on that, I know mainly I talk about my Corvette stuff, but if you'd be interested in seeing that, just let me know as well. And I'll make sure to make a couple of videos outlining that process. So that's going to do it for now, and I'll be checking back in the next couple of days, guys. Thanks for watching.